Welcome back, everybody. In this video, I'm going to pull back the curtain and I'm going to explain what it is that Taylor series really do. So in the last video, we saw some examples of kind of the cool things you can do with a Taylor series. We had a series that added up to pi. We've derived Euler's formula at the end. Really cool stuff. But from my perspective as a mathematician, right, what is it that I do with Taylor series? What's the point of Taylor series? I mean, there are some cool tricks, and we saw some of those, but what's the real deal here? Well, I'm going to show you. So what we can do is ask this question. What's the simplest function you can find that looks like e to the x, or close to zero? Okay. I mean, there's a good first guess, or maybe it's not terribly good, because it doesn't fit terribly well. But what if I said, okay, when x is zero, e to the x is e to the 0, which is 1. So I could just take e to the x and just draw a horizontal line, right, that goes through the graph at the same place, and just say the constant function, 1. That's you know, it's kind of like e to the x right at 0, because if I plug 0 into both the blue function and the red one, I get 1. But, yeah, you're right. I mean, it's not a very good guess, because so maybe it's a good first guess, because once you get away from zero, they don't match up very well, right? Okay, let's try this again. Maybe what we can do is find a nice, easy function that has the same value at zero, right, and also the same derivative. And if you think about it, what that really is the tangent line, right? So this red line now that I've drawn is actually the tangent line at zero. So we're back to calculus one ideas, right? So e to the x is in blue, the tangent line is there in red. And if you check, the tangent line turns out to be 1 plus x. Now if you look really close around zero, what you see maybe is, depending on the resolution of your monitor, it looks kind of purplish, right? You can hardly tell the red tangent line from the blue graph of e to the x if you're very close to the origin. Now once you get further away, they obviously separate because the graph of e to the x curves and the tangent line doesn't. But when they're really close to zero, they look pretty close together. And that's something that you may remember from Calculus 1. We'll often call differentiable functions locally linear, which means if you zoom in on your calculator, for example, close enough to a differentiable function and its tangent line, it's hard to tell them apart if you zoom in close enough, right? So what I have is 1 was my first guess at a simple function. X plus 1 was my next guess at a simple function. In other words, the tangent line. Well, what if I tried to make two derivatives match? In other words, what if I tried to make like a tangent parabola? Right? So that'd be kind of cool. And we never did that in Cal 1. We could have. We just held off on it until now. So here's three graphs. The blue one is e to the x. Right? Then I have my red tangent line. And then in orange there is the tangent parabola. Okay, it matches up with the value of e to the x, right? Because the graph goes through the same point at zero. It has the same derivative, and it has the same second derivative. And you see that it fits pretty close. If I just graphed this, you know, this orange line between, say, negative 1 and 1, it would look pretty close, right? So right around zero, the tangent parabola, right, would almost match exactly. What about three derivatives? Could I find like a tangent cubic, right? Well, what would that be? It'd be something that matches up the first three derivatives, and I'll just draw that graph in there with e to the x, that sort of light purple graph. And maybe you see what that function is, right? I'm writing out the terms in the MacLaurin series, the Taylor series centered at zero. So what's really going on here is I'm finding a polynomial that matches the function and its first several derivatives. And what polynomial is that? Well, it's what you get when you write out the first several terms of the Taylor series. So if my function is e to the x, then this is what I would have, right? The derivative would be e to the x, and when I plug in 0, I just get 1. just like we did before. So it was easy to write out those terms. So what I'm really doing here, right, in writing out this Taylor polynomial, writing out the first, say, three or four or five terms of the Taylor series, is I'm getting a function that's super easy. It's a polynomial, but it matches pretty darn close to a complicated function like e to the x. Let's try another example. So here's sine of x, right? So let's just try graphing sine of x and the very first term of its MacLaurin series, which is x. And of course, what we're getting there is its tangent line. If I try to graph the first two terms of the MacLaurin series, now remember that sine only has odd terms in its MacLaurin series, so we go from x and it jumps up to x cubed, right? And we get this kind of tangent cubic, right? It's a cubic polynomial in black there. And wow, I mean, that dips just like sine does, right? I mean, eventually it shoots off to infinity at the edges, and it doesn't fit exactly once you get far away from zero. But I mean, between, say, negative 1 and 1, you can't tell the difference between the two graphs the way I have them drawn with this resolution. If I went up to the first first three terms of the series, up to the x to the fifth power, well, I mean, darn, that's wrapping around there pretty good. You have to get, almost to 2 before the graphs start to separate enough to tell that they're different. Right. And here's one more. If I went out to the seventh power, I mean, you have to go look right at the edges around 3 and minus 3. You can see some separation. Otherwise, that looks really, really close. I mean, obviously, the first, 2, 4 terms in the MacLaurin series, isn't the same as all of sine, but it's really pretty close. Okay. So why does anybody care? Right. Well, let me ask you a question. How do you think your calculator figures out what sine of, 0.3497236 is? I mean, there's no magic sine elf inside your calculator, right? Like the little elf that used to live in the treehouse that bakes cookies. there's no elf living in your calculator baking trigonometry, right? The calculator has to figure out what sine is some way, right? And all calculators, all computers really are any good at is adding really quickly. Or, of course, that means you can multiply pretty quickly and raise things to powers pretty quickly because that's just adding over and over and just multiplying over and over. So raising things to powers, multiplying and adding, calculators can do really fast. That's really all calculators know how to do. Again, those of you who in the video audience here who are computer science majors going like, I know exactly how all that works. I get all that. Well, think about what your calculator then has to do. How does it know what sine of 0.34967 is? I mean, it claims that it knows. It puts something on your screen and acts like it knows, and you paid a bunch of money for that calculator to tell you what it is. In fact, Siri will tell you what it is if you ask Siri, or I bet Alexa will too. So if you insert your favorite artificial intelligence here. So how does it work? Well, one way to do it, again, the various companies have various tricks that they try, and there are other tricks that work here besides using MacLaurin series or other kinds of series. But the most obvious and straightforward way to do it is to plug in a number into its first several terms of its MacLaurin series. So if I want to know what sine of 0.7 is, right, then what I can do is take 0.7 and just do the first, what does it have on the screen there? The first four terms of the MacLaurin series. And that ought to be pretty close. In fact, it's probably close enough that the first several decimal places match, right? And if the first, say, 8 decimal places match, then you don't really care whether the rest of them do or not, right? Because the first 8 decimal places are all that the screen's going to show you. So all the calculator has to do is add up enough terms of the MacLaurin series to get close enough so that the silly human pushing the buttons doesn't know the difference. That's one of the reasons, one of the really cool reasons that students, at least, who've grown up with calculators and are used to the idea of just punch a button and have it spit out a number, right? This is one of the first places where it maybe resonates, hopefully, as to why these MacLaurin series are really cool. Again, there's no magic elf inside your calculator that tells you, what sine and cosine and such are. Let's do the same thing with cosine real quick so you can see. Here's the first term for cosine. It's just one, so it's a constant function. It's really boring. Here's a tangent parabola, right? And again, it kind of fits with the shape inside there a little better. If I go to the first three terms, so I'm up to x to the fourth power, makes a sort of W-looking graph, and look at that. That's really matching really close around, zero, right? If I go out to the sixth power, I mean, that's really, really, really close, okay? So you can see that if I needed to find cosine of, of 0.32, right, then I don't have to, try to add up all infinitely many terms in my MacLaurin series. If I plug 0.32 into, maybe the first four terms, that may be close enough. Right? There are fancy ways to tell how close we are. Like we had error estimates for alternating series. Well, that's an alternating series, and so we could use those. And there's other kinds of error estimates that you'll learn in more advanced classes to tell just how close we are if we add up the first four terms instead of adding up all infinitely many of them. But that's the trick. That's what your calculator is doing. That's how all of this stuff that you've, grown to rely on your whole life, right? You grab a machine and say, what's cosine of this number? Well, it's doing exactly this. It's just adding up the first several terms in some series. So now maybe the homework, may seem a little less tedious, right? When I ask you to add up the first, five terms of some series, or the first five terms of some series for a function. You'll see that the reason we need to do that is that's exactly what you need to do if you're programming, a calculator or a computer or something to calculate a value for this function. I remember that when I was writing some numerical code when I was a graduate student, and I had needed to find inverse cosine of something. And it didn't have to be exact, it just had to be pretty close. And then I was going to change some stuff and then rerun the program over and over and over again, getting closer and closer every time. And I was using the arc cosine function that was built into the I guess I was writing this in C. And I remember, beating my head against the wall going, oh, why am I so stupid? Because it was actually pretty slow to use the arc cosine function that I was calling over and over and over again when I didn't need to have it correct out to 17 decimal places. I just needed it to be pretty close. And I realized, all I need is like the first three terms of the MacLaurin series for inverse cosine. That would get me an answer that was close enough so that when I ran through the code the next time, and made some changes to the circles and things I was moving around, that it got even closer to the right answer it was supposed to be and moved me in the right direction I was going to have to iterate over. So anyway, I hope that I've impressed upon you that what makes, at least to my mind, MacLaurin series and Taylor series so cool is that they are really an example of polynomials, right, that converge to functions that we are used to using that are complicated, and we can approximate them, right, by using nice, simple polynomials, by just using the first few terms in the series.